The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Got a word at the same time, Janice. Remember, we got a Ustream audience, and there's unsaved people out there.
Okay. You just want me to pray? Okay. Hodiah, Hodiah, Maha, just open up your arms right now. Well, the Holy Spirit is here. And let's just receive and drink in the prayer. Let's go. I just hear the Lord saying that He wants us to partake in His bread today. His bread of life. Whoa! He wants to amaze you. He wants you to dream again. Whoa! He wants to release the Father's heart on you. Someone right now, they're older, and I see like white hair, back problems. I see arthritis, and I just feel like the Lord right now, if that's you, I just lift up your hands right now, and Jesus is going to heal you, and we're just going to release that now in Jesus' name. So right now, I just speak to your body to come in alignment in the name of Jesus. I just release life over your body right now. Right now, I release life right now. Right now, I just see finances, and I just hear the enemy saying, how am I going to do this? I hear these thoughts that's coming in your mind that he's been torturing. How are you going to do this? And I hear the Lord just saying, breakthrough, 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 breakthrough. Somebody, the Lord's been speaking Ephesians 4 to them, and I just hear the Lord just saying, what I said I will do, what I said I will do, you will become that, you will become that. Whoa, mark my word, you will become that. Oh, Holy Spirit, yeah, I just see over here, I'm just feeling right now, somebody was short hair. I know I closed my eyes when I do this, but whoa, Holy Spirit, but I'm feeling in my heart that there was someone who's been dealing with a lot of doubt, and I just feel like the Lord is saying, I'm bringing belief. There's something that's happened in your childhood, and he's making all things new. I just see that he's bringing that awakening, that beauty. It's a woman inside of you, and he's bringing that beauty. I see June. I see the Lord saying, I'm making all things new inside of you, that there's going to be an open door, an open opportunity in your life. Whoa, Holy Spirit. Let's just wait on him. Whoa, he is so good, and he's here. He is here. He is here, and it's Jesus. It's Jesus. Yeah, I just feel like that back pain, it's starting to leave right now. Whoa, right now, right now, right now. Holy Spirit, you're here. Whoa. Let's just wait and drink him in the pleasure of the Lord. Whoa. I had a vision. And I remember, the Lord kept reminding me in worship of how, like, all of a sudden I was taken up to this ship, and I walked in this room, and on the news there was a report of Stonewall Jackson. And I was like, Lord, what is this? And he goes, go save the ship, they're wounded. And so I went on this huge cruise ship, and I started saving everybody on this ship. And I remember the Lord, like, the captain, it started to sink, and the captain, when it started to sink, he felt like a failure. And I feel like the Lord is going to take people out of this because we're going to drink from the pleasure of the Lord today. I really feel that. He felt like a failure because his ship sank. But then when I went to go up to him, I said, the Lord still has a plan for your life. Don't let this thing that's happened to the ship destroy you. So the Lord picked me up and picked him up, and I took him to his wife. And I remember when I took him to his wife, he became new. And Jesus sat me at his table, and he looked, and when I saw him, all of a sudden his eyes turned from the blueberries, and he put his hand right here, and he said, eat the fruit of my spirit. And then I ate it, and then all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit came upon me, and he said, drink the rivers of living water, and the cup filled up, and I started drinking from the river of living water, and this Jewish music came on, and I was possessed by the Holy Ghost, and drinking from the pleasure of the Lord, and I feel like the Stonewall Jackson thing, and I kept on thinking, I was like, Lord, what's that have to do with today? And I feel like the body of Christ is coming because they've been wounded, and he's coming to return to drink the river of living water and eat the fruit and live in the pleasure of the Lord. I feel like it's a time and a season that the body of Christ is going to wake up, and people will want what we have, not because of a service, but because who we are in Christ. And I really feel like that we're going to drink of that pleasure of the Lord, that when we walk into a chaos place, that God's going to bring the pleasure of the Lord, and the pleasure of the Lord is going to be so much on us, and the joy of the Lord is going to possess us so much that people will want what we have. And it's time that the body of Christ is being healed, and that the message is going to be the message of healing, of knowing who we are, and people will want us because they will know that Jesus is in us, and they must have that. And I just release that into the atmosphere right now here on earth, God, that the pleasure of the Lord, the pleasure of the Lord, we just drink that in right now. We drink in your pleasure, Lord, that when we go, God, your pleasure, your joy, your fruit, your river of living water flows in us and through us everywhere we go. That we drink from that river, that you will no longer be wounded, but you will be a healed body of Christ. That's what God's doing right now. Why is your junk coming up? Because God's making all things new. This is a season where he's making all things new. He always is, but this time it's going to be for real and for good. It's not going to be up and down. It's going to be for real and good. So it's good that it's coming out because Jesus is coming in.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated. They pretty much preached my message already.
I just feel like I feel that the Lord is, he's just a warrior, and he is coming for his bride. And where there has been wounding, and what it's done is it's actually conformed the church. It's conformed everybody to look for like one thing, and it's put us all in a box. But I feel that as the healing begins to come, God is a God of creativity, and people are going to begin breaking out into their own because they are connected with the Lord. And as you begin to get this healing, you're not going to begin to look around you what is normal. You're not going to begin to look what your neighbor is doing and try to conform to that. You're going to begin to be so connected that it's like that umbilical cord is going to be so connected, and so it's just like your feeding is going to be coming from the Lord, and that is going to change that conformity that has been in this church. And there is going to begin to be a breaking out of his worldwide body, and there is going to begin to be creativity, for God is a God of creativity, and even like as the rainbow colors. But it's like nobody has seen what is to begin coming on this earth, because God is going to begin breaking out into creativity. We are his rainbow.
Break the cadence of what I think is transpiring here. I'm hearing clear words from the Lord. And I think something that Jennifer and I like to do is when we hear a word there and a word there, it's tying it together. But God is going to be radically changing his body at an accelerated rate. And the things that people are used to struggling. You know what? We make things harder than they need to be. Do you believe that? We can. Because if we've been churched for any length of time, we have a tendency to make it harder. It's like if God gave you an opportunity to go by plane or by covered wagon, some of us are so steeped in the structure of the old ways that we would take the covered wagon. I don't know about you. I'm for change, transition, and acceleration. And God's doing a new work. And one of the works he's doing is basically the message today. Bad roots and good roots. How many even know what a root is? Ladies are thinking, I need my hair done when I talk about roots. No, there's good roots and bad roots. But here's what I feel is the word of the Lord for today. The word of the Lord is God said basically that in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. All right? Now, just taking from that premise that the Word of God is God, God, Jesus and his Word are one. Do you agree with that? All right? And he won't contradict, his personhood won't contradict his Word, and his Word won't contradict his personhood. And as a young believer, when I wanted to go to school, God wouldn't let me. He says, I'm going to take you to the school of the Spirit. One of the first things he did was, he says, you're going to learn the word, but you're going to learn how that word works. It's one thing to know the word. It's another thing to know how it works. Wisdom trumps knowledge. Knowledge is great, but wisdom is the application of that knowledge. And I wanted to know the way that God works. And so I want to kind of cover some of those initial teachings that the Lord took me through when he wouldn't let me go to Bible school initially. Later, he let me do anything I wanted to do. But at first, he said, I want to take you to the school of the Spirit because there's some things I want to teach you that is going to be a re-education of the status quo. And what it was that the Word and Jesus are one, that he was a person, and that if I understood the way the Word works, I would understand the way Jesus works. Does that make sense? So everything I looked for was pattern and principle. I was looking for how does God normally teach? How did he teach Moses his ways? All right? I'm used to seeing the demonstration, but I wanted to see how did he do it? And basically, God took me to the concept of roots. Interestingly enough, one of the times that with my open eyes, I saw a demonic manifestation, it was on a young man. And the demonic manifestation was like a superimposed over his face. He was like this. And it was a spirit of pride that looked like a bald Humpty Dumpty. And the head was tilted back, and he was talking to me. And he was saying, you don't understand. I'm a complicated... Now, he might have had bifocals, too. So I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. But I saw a spirit of pride, and it wasn't bifocals. He had a condescending, even tilt back the head in that. And when I saw that demon flash over his face, God said, that's a spirit of pride. And he was proud in how intelligent he was and how complicated he was. And the Lord just dropped that word in me, and I just basically said, well, you know, I want you to minister to me, but you have to understand, Dennis, I'm a complicated person. And I said, well, good, because I only deal with roots, not the complicated branches. Roots are simple. By humility, you're rooted in God, and pride, you're rooted in Satan. Let's go for roots. And it humbled him enough to go that complication and all of the way he made it so hard was actually quite simple. It's either God or it's the devil. Let's face it. So let's go for root issues. And what the Lord was showing me was basically Hebrews 12, 14, and 15, where it says, pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord, looking carefully lest you fall short of the grace of God, lest any bitter root or root of bitterness spring up. Now listen to this. It springs up. That means where is it? It's down here. This is where you get wounded. You know, even the Proverbs 18:8 says, the words of a gossip are like tasty morsels, but they are as wounds that go down into the innermost parts of the belly. You might hear what someone says here, but you get wounded here. This is the seat of the emotions. This is the innermost being. The spirit of man's a candle of the Lord, searching all the innermost rooms of the belly, because that's the area he wants to root out. And that's what God basically starts showing me. He says, a bitter root springs up in you. It causes you trouble and thereby defiles others. It defiles others in two ways. One, your attitude is like you walk around with barbed wire. You poke people that you come in contact with, and they distance themselves. Or you've got a sign on you, kick me, I'm a wounded person, I'm hurt, and people are drawn to pick on you. Do you believe that's possible? That you could promote that? It's based on the law of sowing and reaping. What you sow, you reap. A bitter root is nothing more than unforgiveness that you forgot about. Just because you forgot about an area of unforgiveness, it is still operating in you based on the law of sowing and reaping. You can't use the excuse, I can't think of anybody to forgive, because David says, search me, O God. What Jennifer says, there's 2,000 thought patterns consciously at any given moment. And most of it's wasted on, I'm too hot, I'm too cold, I'm hungry, what time is the service over? All right, that's most of your 2,000. But there's 400 billion in the non-conscious. You want to root out evil out of your heart? You let God do the searching. You say, God, you search my heart for anxious thoughts, hurtful ways. Anxious thoughts means every wounding is an emotion attached to a thought. And if you really want to see the mind renewed and see the truth rise up, to pull down a mental stronghold, you have to first deal with the power source. If you don't deal with the authority, every word, if I were to speak a word to Janice right now, every word, she would understand the content of what I said to her, but there would be a power behind it, good or bad. That's what has to be dealt with, not the communication. The devil can quote scripture, but I think the communication would be lacking substance and anointing, don't you think? Yeah. So there's the two, the more invisible realm. So anyway, beware lest any bitter root spring up in you. It causes you problems, but it also defiles others. And so the Lord said, okay, Dennis, I'm going to show you how the word works. And if I teach you how the word works, you're going to understand how Jesus works. You're going to understand how the Holy Spirit works. And he took me to Jeremiah 1, verses 9 and 10. This is actually the text that we're going to use this morning. Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. And I loved it because God was teaching me and answering my question in the school of the Spirit. I said, how does the word work? I know what the word says. I wanted application. I've always hungered for how to. The right answer is insufficient for me. Knowing what to do, I wanted to know how to do it. And I think this is a beautiful layout for a young believer, for God to just open up my heart and say, this to this day is still consistent. This is the way Jesus works. This is the way God works in your heart. This is the way the Holy Spirit works. This is the way the word works. And it said to Jeremiah, I put my words in your mouth. You think those were anointed? I put my words in your mouth. See, I have this day set you over the nations and over the kingdoms. That's power. And here's what my words are going to do. They are going to root out, pull down, destroy, throw down, build and plant. And I saw one of the most important functions of the Word of God and the work of Jesus in me was that before he can really build and plant, you know what? You need to prepare the foundation. You need to prepare the soil. And in this portion of Scripture, there's an alternation between planting and building. And all through Scripture, I saw the pattern. Does he not always talk about a foundation and building? And doesn't he also talk about being trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord? So there is a major key in understanding how God works, how the Word works, how the Holy Spirit works, how Jesus works, with understanding planting and building. Because there's a way that he does it, and I want to cooperate with that way. So here's the first thing that I saw. He said, first of all, we like to just drink in the word and believe it's going to be planted in the heart. But you know what I found out? I found out that there's all kinds of soil. Like in Mark chapter 4, there's all kinds of soil that maybe I need to have something rooted out, like sin. We don't talk about that much anymore. Maybe I need to root out the weeds to prepare the soil to receive, to build, and to plant. Now, we're alternating in these portions of Scripture. The first one is that to root out. And when I looked that up, it was basically to root out sin. I let the Holy Spirit in me search me and root out anything that's coming between me and my God, because he's a person. I'm not making religion out of it. I'm saying out of my relationship. He showed me that any toxic emotion in me was an indication something was coming between me and my God. Something was coming, not just between me and the Word and obedience to the Word, but the Word, the living Word. And so I learned early on that even a negative feeling in my gut was coming between me and my God, and I wanted it removed. That is rooting out. I root it out. Not only do I root out what is obvious, I let him search my heart for, say, God, where did I give place to the devil in that in my life? Because you know what? I'm a Spirit-filled Christian moving in the gifts of the Spirit, and I see the same old. How many know what a same old is? A repetitive cycle. If you see a repetitive cycle, there's a root. You didn't, God didn't make you that way. You got that way all by yourself, by your response. And it's an ungodly response if the cycle is bad. It's a root of unforgiveness. You may have forgotten about it, but I'll tell you what, in the wisdom of God, who knows all things, he knit you together in your mother's womb. That's the one I once searched in my heart. Search me, O God, for any anxious thoughts or hurtful ways. We used to pray with people like that, and they get so religious, we'd say, okay, let God search your heart for anxious thoughts and hurtful ways. No, that's not real hard to understand. And they would say, oh, I see my mother. I love my mother. And we go, that's not quite the point. We're not looking for your virtues. We're not looking for the right religious answer. We're looking for God to search your heart and make it clean. All right? So you know not to do that, right? Don't ever pray that with me. Don't give me the right religious answer. You have your own relationship with Jesus, and let the Spirit of truth reveal to you what needs to be dealt with. All right, so we're rooting out. How do I get started? It's basically understanding that I gave ground. Doesn't the scripture say to give no place to the devil? Wherever you give him place, he has legal ground. And I'm saying what the Lord's shown me is any legal ground gives him permission to torment. Therefore, I don't want to give him place. I very simply ask God, where did that get started? Is that hard? Where did that get started in my life? Because I've watched Spirit-filled people who moved into gifts, who hypothetically, one example would be, they hated men before they got saved and they hated men after they got saved. Would you say there's still an unredemptive part of their life? Huh? Was it covered under the blood? Yes, it was covered under the blood legally, but vitally, they haven't done anything about it. So you'd say, God, search me. Where did that get started? And God, a lot of times, will reveal the starting point, and you receive repentance and forgiveness from that starting point, and you will see a freedom that cleans, to see the cross. The cross breaks the cycle. It's the only thing that breaks the cycle, and it breaks it instantly through repentance. That cycle, once broken, sets you free from reaping what you sowed. That's the only thing that breaks it. So I looked at this, and God's basically talking, in rooting out, he's talking about the soil of my heart. Root it out to prepare the soil. Get rid of known sin, and even letting God search your heart. For where have I hardened my heart gradually? Where have I allowed entry point? And God basically said, because ultimately that bad root is going to give place to a good root. And how about the engrafted word of God? Have you ever heard that term, engrafted word? What God wanted to do is show how to receive the engrafted word that's able to save your soul. I saw the engrafted word as I didn't have the word up here. I had the word here, and it was being written on the tablet of my heart, a residue of the divine nature I was drinking in. I owned it. And how did I know? I used to test it by the fruit. How did I know if I owned that word? It was easier to obey than not to obey. That told me it took, kind of like a vaccination, all right? It was more than a vaccination because it was easier to obey than to not obey. So I says, okay, I understand, God, I've got to root out. The cleaner I keep my heart in my relationship, the more I don't let anything toxic come between you and I together, then I'm rooting out. But that next word basically said that pull down altars. And I went, wait a minute, now we're switched to building. The first one had to do with planting, root out. Now we switch to pull down altars. And I'm going, pull down altars. What is an altar? And God began to show me it's like a house of thoughts, mental strongholds that needed to be brought down. House of thoughts, systems. Things that were factual, and listen to this, believers, because if you want to make some progress in being renewed, you've got to make a distinction between facts and scripture. Because people, factual is like, well, it's been like this my whole life, that's a fact. But the fact remains that it's in contrast to the scripture. If it's in contrast to the scripture, you need, that's a stronghold. But you can't get the stronghold down if you don't deal with the power source from the heart. All matters of the heart are the heart of the matter. God, you have to start with the heart. You have to have a gut mindset. There's a term for you to think about. How do I get, because we're not throwing this away. We're bringing the place of power, the mind of Christ here to influence this and have a gut mindset. Mind, will, and emotions under the lordship of Jesus. It's lordship. It's rule. A gut mindset. So God basically said, I want to teach you how to pull down the altars. And what was interesting is we all know the scripture in 2 Corinthians 10. We know that as the word of God is there for casting down arguments and high things that exalts itself. The weapons of our warfare, they're what? Not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and high things that exalt itself against the knowledge of God. Well, God brought us to the Message translation. This is the casual translation. It says, we use our powerful God tools. I like that. We use that regularly now. We use our powerful God tools for smashing warped philosophies, tearing down barriers that are erected against the truth so that we can build and fit together every loose thought, emotion, and impulse. There's mind, will, and emotions. He wants to fit them together in a life structured by Jesus. Does that sound good? He's building something. So in pulling down, root out, pull down, the pulling down. Remember, what is this? This is the word working in the prophet Jeremiah. This is what the words from your mouth is going to do. But how is it going to do it? Building and planting was last. There were some things that preceded the way the word works. And how did it's going to, first we got to root out the sin and the blockages in your life. We got to clean that heart out. Secondly, we got to pull down strongholds that are exalting themselves against the knowledge of God. The Message says he wants to fit every loose thought, emotion, and impulse into a structure of a life shaped by God. Our tools, now I love this part. This is our ministry. Our tools are ready at hand. So now you're without excuse. You have an anointing that abides within. These tools are ready at hand for you when there's nobody around. You and your Jesus when there's nobody around. These tools are ready and they're at hand. The toolbox is in you. The God tools are in you. What we fail to see sometimes is we just name the tools. When God wants us to take, how do these tools work? How does the word work? How does Jesus work in me? Well, he wants to root out as far as planting something in you. He wants to pull down high things that are exalting themselves against the knowledge of God so that the beautiful part is that then the truth rises up. You can't get the truth to rise up and be written on the tablet of your heart and get your total transformation of mind, will, and emotions as long as there's a stronghold. You know how a stronghold sounds for a lot of you? You've been in the church for many years, and you'll hear stuff like, I know God loves me, but. The but tells me there's a stronghold there, that word of God hasn't penetrated. You don't own it yet. You are not a partaker of the divine nature yet. You have not the residue of that ruling in your heart. You still got an argument that's exalting itself against that word. Do you believe that? So God's basically saying, I'm going to teach you how to pull down. And I'm going to teach you, first of all, Dennis, the hardest one are the ones that are factual. Facts can be repeated so many times in your life, you call it truth. And that's the devil's tool. That's not a God tool. That's a devil tool. The truth is that because it's been repeated over and over again, and it's factual, God loves to take those facts and work the impossible work of death, burial, and resurrection. He likes to take the compost pile of those mistakes and lies and build something beautiful on top of them. Doesn't he? And he did, and he will. All right, so only a stronghold argues with the truth, by the way. So you can tell me your facts, but you don't understand. As soon as I hear you don't understand, I know that it's not about me. Tell that to Jesus. Tell Jesus he don't understand. And they don't go that route. But only a stronghold argues with the truth. And it will use facts. A stronghold is a proud thing, just like that vision that I had that superimposed over that man. It's a proud thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. I'm a complicated person. I'm very difficult. No, roots are roots. See, you're either primarily rooted in Satan or rooted in God. Which one do you want to go for? See, people like to talk about the flower tops and the complications and all the many branches and all the possible variations, where God just goes, I want your heart. I want what's inside you. Man looks at that outward appearance. God's looking at the heart. I want the source. And see, for me, from the time I was a baby Christian, discernment was everything to me, because my word for discernment, even as a baby Christian, was distinction, differentiation. To discern is to differentiate. Doesn't Jesus work that way? For the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword, able to divide asunder or make a distinction between soul and spirit, joints and marrow. But here's the part that melted my heart. We're talking about the word of God, right? And God's telling me that if the word works this way, Jesus works this way, the Holy Spirit works this way. So it says the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword, dividing asunder between soul and spirit. What are we talking about? The word of God, the living word. The living word, right? Verse 13 says, and all things are naked and open to the eyes of him. And I saw the beauty of the personhood, and the relationship with the word needs not be ink on a page, but written on the tablet of our heart as a living word. And that's just melted my heart, that we shouldn't be struggling with understanding the word up here. If we knew it in here, it would explain himself. He will reveal himself. This is he who loves me. And I, to him, I will reveal myself. So it's basically a love message from down in the heart, your Bible heart. All right, so pull down. We're on building, right? We said these scriptures alternate between planting and building. Root out has to do with the ground. Pull down altars has to do with the structure of the building. The concept of bad roots and good roots. We also see, too, that what he taught me about the will, that the will is not here. We used to go to churches, 98% of the people would point here when I'd say, where's their will? Your will here, this is the door of the heart, this is the will, this is where you yield. And the Lord showed me that to understand the lordship of Jesus, to walk and be established, built up and established. Remember it says, as you received him, so walk. So I says, okay, how did I receive him? I want to know how. And God showed me, well, whether you knew it or not, you opened the door of your heart. Open. I put off the old man, O-F-F. I put him off. O-F-F. I opened. I received forgiveness for my sin. And I had peace or fruit of the Spirit. That was pretty simple, wasn't it? Open, forgive. Fruit. I put off the old man. So he said, but as you received him, walk the same way. So I said, oh, here's how the word works then. I have to walk open to the Lord as a constant. How do I know if I'm open? Well, I have to walk in a forgiveness lifestyle, because if there's any yuck in here, it's because I've got ought and I'm not pursuing peace with all men. I'm going to get a bitter root if I don't watch it. So I open. You are the most forgiven people on the face of the earth. You should be the most forgiving people. So it's not unnatural for us to say you should be walking not just for understanding forgiveness, a forgiveness lifestyle. Anything that interrupts you and the Lord should be, you should release forgiveness toward God, toward self, toward others, whatever is impairing that relationship, spirit to spirit, heart to heart, breath to breath. And so God basically showed me that in the will, this was remarkable. I only knew the flesh understanding of the will. Fight, get in your face. You ever felt somebody, you can feel the push, and you feel like walking backwards? You can either fight back, run away and hide, or lay down and let people walk over you. Does that appeal to anybody? Fight, flight, faint. Is that appealing? No. And I used to see people in my church, they're worried about controlling people. And I'm going, how come that doesn't bother me? And God showed me, because you are under control. You can't control someone who's under control. And he gave me a beautiful picture. The picture was of Jesus when they went to push him off a cliff. I know what he did. He just yielded to the will of the Father and walked through the crowd. He did not fight them. He did not run away, and he did not lay down and let them trample him. It was a beautiful picture of the way God intended us to live as Sabbath sons and Sabbath daughters, to practice the presence of God, to walk in that peace. That peace is militant. If it's not your time, trust me, nobody can control someone who's under control. If Jesus is Lord at any given moment, nobody can control you if you are under control. Right? How do you know if you're under control? Peace. I told you, in this church, you'll never get a wrong answer if you say forgiveness or peace. You stand a real good chance of doing well. All right? So, Jesus just showed me, first, I'm going to yield to God. I'm going to use my God tools. I'm going to pull down any lie. Now, here's the beautiful part, and we watch this when we minister to people. This is my most favorite part, is when a person finally cleanses the heart, renounces a lie that they walked in most of their life. They renounce that lie. What's made available now? When you renounce that lie, remember before you say, I know God loves me, but... Well, once that power source has been removed, they are a candidate, and I will have them close their eyes and say, what's the truth? And they'll say, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I'm the apple of his eye. And when they say it, there is such an anointing on it that they own it. They're not just speaking the word that they heard in their head or memorized. They are speaking out of a now rhema word, and it gets written on the tablet of their heart, and they become a partaker of that divine nature, and nobody, including them, can erase it. You can't erase what God writes on the heart. Now, there's good news. You can go deeper, like an engram, just like pouring hot water over Jello. It'll cut grooves in there. Don't you want some grooves cut in some of that word that is real to you? Most of you, the word that's cut deep in you, you've written in the front of your Bible years ago. How many have certain scriptures in the front of your Bible? You know what that is? That's Holy Ghost railroad tracks, so that if you get a little off base and get a little cranky with God, you go back to that word, and it has a way of getting you back to your prime directive. Mine and Jennifer's were different, but yet we both need what God gave us. And mine is that I might know him, that I might progressively become more intimately acquainted with all the wonders of his person. And that has never died, and it's never been more real, and it only goes deeper. That I might know him, that I might progressively become more intimately acquainted. What's yours, Jennifer? Wasn't it Jeremiah 29? That I know the plans that I have for you. So when things don't make sense, she goes to, I know the plans that he has for us, plans for welfare, not calamity, to give me a future and a hope. That's usually a good one when you feel like, oh my goodness, this looks pretty hopeless out here in the natural. That's when God does it perfectly. All right, I want to move on. All right, so the next word goes back to the ground again. And I thought this was interesting when I did a study. Everybody's familiar with the parable of the soils, but he says, that word that I put in your mouth, Jeremiah, I'm going to root out, I'm going to pull down those strongholds, those family altars, those house of thoughts, and I'm going to destroy. And it was destroy the ground. I didn't quite get that at first. He wants to destroy the ground. You know what he wants to do? He wants to put weed killer in your spirit and destroy it for anything evil to grow. It's kind of like weed and feed. You can put that on your lawn and it helps nourishes the grass, but it kills the weeds. And so when I said destroy, basically when I did a word study, it's like, you know, I want to remove the stones and the hardness from your heart. I want to deal with the hardness, and I want to break up the fallow ground. Fallow ground means it once produced but got hard. I want to deal with that hardness, and I want to basically soften that so that it's like 100-fold return. You want to see 100-fold return, you need that kind of soil in the heart. So God basically says, I want to destroy your heart for anything that's evil. I want to prepare it for the good stuff. All right? So there's the ground. And then the last one was throw down. In other words, throw down refers back to building. So this word and Jesus, they're working like this in my life. God wants to build in my life, but what's he say? First of all, you know those strongholds that I tore down? You know those things that erected themselves against the knowledge of God? You know those towers? I flattened them, and I'm going to build on that foundation something beautiful. Did you know, didn't civilizations build on the ruins of previous civilizations? They used it as a foundation. God says, I'm going to pull down those strongholds. And listen to this. This is the good news. Those of you that have struggled with the same kinds of thoughts, the same kind of mental strongholds, on the other side is your strongest anointing. The biggest enemy in my life as a child growing up was rejection. You know what my strongest anointing is? Acceptance. And God bombarded me with acceptance to where I didn't need it from people. God said, I'm giving you my undivided attention. My thoughts are continually toward you. You're the apple of my eye. And my thoughts toward you are more numerous than the grains of the sands of the sea. And to be bombarded with that, it made absolutely no difference if anybody paid any attention to you. And I could have sat and used the excuse, but you don't understand. I was rejected my whole life. You don't understand. I was invisible. It doesn't matter. Because God says, the problem is that we have learned to find substitutes. And this is the word of the Lord, and I heard it through the people. This is a season where Jeremiah is going to come to pass in the sense that my people have committed two evils. They've forsaken me, the fountain. And there's no vacuums. They found a substitute to get their needs met. And that is what's going to change. He's going to be Lord. He's going to be first place. You're going to return to really first love, not baby love, mature love as a priority. Because I'm seeing too much that what God's trying to throw down is that I want to build up a new structure. And there's too much of a lack of trusting God. There's too much control in your Christian walk. And God says, basically, I want to see those things thrown down so that I can, what does the scripture say? Build and plant. Isn't that interesting that all of that preceded building and planting? Before God could really build or plant in your life, all of that root out, pull down, destroy, throw down, now I can build and plant. That's the way Jesus works. That's the way the Holy Spirit works. That's the way the Word works. And when we understand that, we begin to see how it happens. Now, here is the, can we run the overhead? I'm going to give you the fast version. This is the way the Lord instructed me. Now, it looks kind of mechanical and formula, but for me, it was total relationship. He showed me that I learned how to receive here the Word of God. I learned how it would rise up and take the place of a mental stronghold written on the tablet of my heart and mind. But God basically said, here's what I want you to do, Dennis. I want you, first of all, to recognize that you have a choice in the morning when you get up. Just plain old willpower. You can choose. And the choice that you make is spending time with God and giving him first place in your life. And when I said that, there was both an outward and an inward discipline. And I closed my eyes and I would sink into him. And the moment that I touched him, spirit to spirit, that for me was prayer. Prayer was not talking initially. Prayer was being with someone. And when I would make that choice, for lack of a better word, because this is all subjective, I absorbed his presence. I would drink instead of think. I would feed instead of read. Does that make sense? Feed and read, which means I enjoyed his pleasure. I heard that word given this morning. For me, the will of God is his pleasure. I don't know where religious people get this drudgery thing, but for me, the will of God was synonymous to his pleasure. I delight to do his will. It was not punishment. It was not making you miserable, and that was a sign that you were carrying your cross. For me, the cross was death, burial, and resurrection to anything that comes between me and my God. Any negative. So I saw that absorbing was basically, I'm saying, say I'm absorbing the Lord is my shepherd. That was the scripture for the morning. The Lord is my shepherd. I don't want to read the Lord is my shepherd. I wanted to know my shepherd. So I would basically welcome it. And a lot of times when I'm looking at the Lord is my shepherd, I want that divine nature imparted to me. I want no-so. I don't want no-so here. I want to acknowledge him here. And the shepherd would begin to make me feel safe and secure. And I'm going, oh. That makes sense. I'm feeling safe and secure in my spirit. I'm absorbing it. And you know what he was doing? He was birthing an attitude. And God was saying, oh, John Maxwell used to say, attitude determines your performance. But I'm not thinking of this attitude. I'm thinking of the predisposition of my heart. Because it's the heart that flow the issues of life. So the attitude that I was birthing in here was my shepherd, my Jesus, the good shepherd, the chief shepherd. It was the great shepherd. It was like I wanted to know him in all those aspects, and I was feeling safe and secure. And that was the way my inner man understood and acclimated to his divine nature. And I saw that I was birthing a new attitude. My attitude toward reading that scripture was knowing him. And after he birthed that attitude, God says, basically, you own that now. You are a partaker of the divine nature experientially. And lastly, I saw that my value system was not ink on the page alone. My value system was that I know him. He's a person. Yes, he's the good shepherd. Yes, he's Psalm 23. Yes. But now my value system is the safety and the security that I feel on the inside. Nobody can take that away. Man can't give it. I can't even take it away because it's real on the inside of me. I saw the importance that your value system as the Word of God needs to be how much Word is really substance and how much is up here. We have a tendency to know more up here than we know here. But for me, the challenge as a baby Christian in the school of the Spirit, God basically said, that's the way the inworking and how the Word is made flesh in you and how to get properly rooted in the good stuff. Now, we already told you, you got to get rid of stuff, but at the same time, make room for this. This was my daily prayer. Then once I had that value system, God basically said, I'm going to give you a truth, Dennis. I'm going to teach you how to cultivate that truth, but then I'm going to put you to the test, and you have to look in hindsight and honestly write down in your journal, do you see the fruit? What if all Christians did that? What if all Christians did that instead of saying, that was a good sermon? What if they actually put themselves to the test and said, there was a truth. I'm going to apply myself to cultivate that truth, and then I'm going to let God test my heart later and see if there's any fruit. What's the fruit? It starts working. You start believing it. You start living it. You live the word. You don't just speak the word. Amen. But I'll tell you what. When that word is your value system, you're connected to the living God. You're joined to the Lord. And the power source then is on your words. I never worry about someone that's connected to the love of God prophesying to somebody, because if they're at peace, It's bathed in love. You're speaking the truth in love. You're not going to go wrong when the love of God is connected to. So I saw the connection. Of course, how do you maintain a connection? You need a forgiveness lifestyle because you get disconnected periodically, right? But there's birthing a new attitude. And what I saw that attitude was basically gratitude. And I says, God, is that the way the word works? If I really have you as my value system, and if I'm really connected to you, do I have an attitude of gratitude? And he says, as you received him, so walk. So I went back to, how did I get saved? I went, I opened, I received forgiveness for my sin, and I felt peace with God. And he said, yeah, basically, what did you do after that? And I said, thank you. Oh, did anybody teach you to say thank you? No, I opened my heart, I received forgiveness, and I felt peace. And then it was just automatic. I went, thank you, Jesus. And God says, as you received him, so walk the same way. So what is he doing? He's basically saying, if you're walking in the Spirit and you're walking in the light as he is in the light, you're having fellowship with God, you're having fellowship with one another, you're walking a forgiveness lifestyle, you are going to be grateful. You are going to be fulfilled. You are going to enter into an abundant life. It's not going to be a mystery. It's not going to be that elusive joy that people talk about, but I don't have any. Like Jennifer went to a seminar on joy, but nobody had any. But they could give you every scripture on it. One lady, I had joy one time. Okay. I don't know what happened. That attitude of gratitude is the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is the sense of his strength on the inside and a gratitude for everything. I'm grateful for this woman up front here. I just look at her face and it causes bubbles of appreciation to rise up. And that's the way you all look at your wives, correct? If not, we might have a bitter root, all right? All the guilty people are giggling. Motivation. What is, if God himself, his divine nature is your value system, the outworking in everyday life, you are motivated by the love of God, the character of God, and the attitude of God. It doesn't get any better. Because then you're not wasting your time in dead works. And your behavior will basically be, and listen to this, because this is what I feel is missing too often in some of our giftedness, a redemptive solution. If you're truly walking in the character and the nature of God, you should have a redemptive mindset. Do you agree? I'll never forget when Bill Morford gave those three scriptures. He wasn't even that excited about it. I fell in love with it. I ran with it. Did you know out of 33 double I ams in the Bible, I am, that emphasis, he found three that were significantly different. And it was I am, actually it was, what was it? Anohi, Anohi, but he says there were three that was Ani, Ani, almost like
three that were Anohi.
Three that were Anohi. Okay, there's my Hebrew lesson for the day. But those three distinctive differences revealed to me the heart of the Father. You know what those three verses were? They're all found in Isaiah. The first one is, I am your deliverer, and there's none that can save but me. So much for the ways, many ways to God, right? I am, and I've got an attitude about this, and I can say this, but nobody else can say this. That's the emphasis. I can say this, but nobody else can say this. Other people can say things, but I alone can say this. I am your deliverer, and there's none that can deliver besides me. That's the character of my Father. I wish I would have gotten saved by that scripture. I would have known him more intimately. I am. Thank you, God, because I was in the mire. I was in the muck, and I felt pretty hopeless. So thank God you're the only one that can do it, and you did it. The second one was, I am. And I'm the only one that can say this. And this is important truth. This is part of our ministry. I am the one who cleanses and washes away your transgressions, and nobody else can do that. In other words, there's no other, only Jesus can forgive sin. I am your forgiver, and nobody else can do this. I remove the transgression. I take your pain and your sorrow. The third one was, and I love this, I am your comforter, and no one else can comfort you. In other words, all are false comforts, but the comforter of the Holy Spirit himself. All those other things are band-aids. And God's basically saying, my people committed two evils. They forsake me, the fountain, and they've hewn for themselves a substitute to meet their needs. Oh, Jesus, I love, but I love my adventure. I love my movies. I love my car. I love my dog. That's like scattered charms in Jeremiah. You're not totally backslidden, but you are, because you haven't put him first place. He might be your Savior, but he's not your Lord. Everything we teach is Lordship of Jesus. Everything. Because the day when you can just get by with him being your Savior, is you're going to be left in the dust. Because it's going to have to take first place. And this is what this is teaching. And God's basically saying that motivation of, so let's say we got saved by those three scriptures. I'm going to close with this. I want to do that lively song at the end because most of you are under conviction. If Those were the only three verses that I knew as a baby Christian, supposing, hypothetically. I would see the love of my Father doing something for me that no man on planet Earth, no woman on planet Earth could do for me. What did he say? I receive it, and in order to be a son, if I want to do like Jesus, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. I would want to say, then God, I'm going to be a deliverer mindset person. I'm going to be a redemptive-oriented person. Redemption is the name of the game, and I'm not moving from that because that's, he's the Father of lights, and I'm a son of light, right? Therefore, I should be reflecting that I want to see redemption. That is my prime directive, is redemption. Now, Sid's redemption is for the unsaved, and many yours is primarily for the unsaved, but she's developing a heart to seeing that the saved need discipled. And I want to evangelize the areas of the heart that have been hardened, been overlooked, ignored, and denied, and people have given up as hopeless. I want to shine a light in those places. I want to let the Holy Spirit go because I'm saying Jesus the Forgiver lives in you and he wants to take that pain and that sorrow. And unless he takes that pain and the sorrow, you remain the same. Really. It doesn't go anywhere. It just gets submerged. So I said, I am going to be like my Father. I'm going to be a forgiver. I'm going to be a redemptive-oriented person to see people removed from the darkness in their life. I'm going to be a forgiving person. I have to practice what I'm preaching. And lastly, I love this part. What people really need very often, more than a prophetic word, is I'm going to comfort them with the same comfort whereby they were comfort, where I was comforted in my time of affliction. A true son, if I've known experientially the comfort of God, I have an obligation to give that. And I can give it because you can't give something you don't have. And you can't even be open to something. I mean, you can't even receive something you're not open to. But I'm telling you, many people are hurting. What they need is a supernatural comfort from God because they are indulging in all kinds of false comforts. And I'm saying God wants to be the true comforter. I am the only one that can comfort you. Everything else is a substitute and a false comfort. Do you see those three aspects of my Father? Then we should be Sabbath sons and Sabbath daughters that exemplify those same things. That's what we should be endeavoring to do, to grow in the grace and in the knowledge of God, exemplifying those three. I'm going to be a deliverer. I'm going to be a forgiver. And I'm going to be a Holy Spirit comforter. And I'll tell you what, in war-torn countries, they need the real comfort of the Holy Spirit more than they need food and clothing. You know that? People can meet the food and clothing, but how many are giving them that personal relationship with Jesus to where they feel the comfort that will be the only comfort that will ever satisfy their heart. So, Father, we just pray right now. Let's do that lively. But first, I want to pray for anyone. If you don't know the Lord as your personal Savior and you're watching by Ustream, if you're attending one of our house groups, I feel like there's a woman in particular in Missouri that needs to hear this. And so, Father, right now, I've been in church for a long time, but I don't know that I have that no-so. And I want you to open your heart, your Bible heart right now, and say, I receive the Lord Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Cleanse me of my sin, and I will live for you and serve you all the days of my life. And if you just said that prayer, say, thank you will be automatic. You won't be told to say thank you. That will be the response of having a subjective no-so of a changed life. There's a nice atmosphere in here right now. I just want to pray continually, God, open my heart. There's actually a weight coming down right now, so let's just enjoy it. That's the kabod. I welcome the weight of God's presence. There's a comfort. There's a blanket. Comfort ye my people. I believe he's comforting right now. I just see like troubled seas, and I just believe that Jesus himself is rising up in the midst of the congregation saying, peace be still. There's anxieties, turmoil. I want you to drink in Drink in the peace of God, that peace that says, peace be still. You got to be able to sleep in the boat in order to stand up and command the storm. Peace be still. That's good. I want you to just kind of slip up your hand. How many people could see a bad root while during the message? You saw a same old, same old. Anybody? You see the same old, same old? Okay. Close your eyes. We're going to pray that through. That cycle, whatever it is, it started. God, I'm asking you, Sean, where did I give in to that? Nod your head when you... situation. Where did I give in to that? There you go. All right. Allow yourself to feel that feeling. Receive forgiveness for letting that toxic emotion in. Release forgiveness to whosoever. Out of my belly flows a river of forgiveness. Might go to someone else. Might go to yourself. Just drink it in. Receive it like a gift. Some people even need to release that judgment they made against God. Why did God let that happen? I release any judgments against God. God showed you the point of entry or where you gave place to it. The entire cycle through a genuine work of the cross is removed. And you should see the ensuing fruit. It's that simple. All right, now here's my favorite part. How many feel like you got good soil right now? You feel peace? We're going to plant something good in there now. If you prayed through the other thing, there was a negative. Close your eyes and say, God, what is the truth? Nod your head if you see the truth. You got it? Oh boy, that's good. All right. Let that truth rise up and say, God, write that truth on the tablet of my heart by the finger of the Holy Spirit. Engrave it in the tablet of my heart, that truth. And how will you know if it's a subjectively happening? It'll feel good. God is good. And for the benefit of those watching by Ustream, let me show you. Jennifer, would you stand up here for a moment? Let me show you. I just feel led to do this. There are people who have been churched and not even sure if they've had a legitimate salvation experience. You know, that can happen. You can be in church for a long time and not know if you're really, I think I'm saved. You ever had that pastor say, everybody say that? I'm not sure. I would go to the altar 15 times. All right. Here's a spirit test that will remove it. I have them put their hand here, down by their spirit. This is the door of the heart. Have them close their eyes in an attitude of prayer. And I don't want them to tell me what they think. I want them to tell me just a simple, does it feel good or bad? Isn't that simple? Because you have an anointing on the inside that can tell you good truth from error, right from wrong. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon me, that I should be called a child of God. That feel good? Well, we know she's saved then. She has the assurance of her salvation. Because I'll tell you what, I prayed it with people that were in church for a long time, and they said it felt yucky. You know what that means? They were living in mental ascent. We had a man in one of our modules, churched for years and years and years. I said, how does it feel? And he went, yucky. We led him through a sinner's prayer. And the men said he was in the men's room looking in the mirror, smiling at himself. He knew that he knew he had a countenance change, right? Thank you, Zia. So, Father, seal this work right now by the power of the Holy Spirit. Open our hearts to celebrate what God is doing and will continue to do. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. God.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.